Okay, so welcome everyone. And so I'm really happy to introduce Fabio. Fabio Cipriani is a friend of many years, and he's going to talk on spectral densities and hypertraces in non-commutative geometry. Fabio, please.
Thank you, Gianni and Walter and all of you. I will report some progress on the themes of spectral density, which is a joint work with Jean-Luc Sauvageau, and it will appear this year in the journal. To try to fix the frame of our today's discussion, we can think to the spectral of atomic elements or molecules, and in this spectra, of course, are fundamental importance the position of the spectral line, but also the multiplicity of the spectral lines, especially when the system is coupled with an external force field, electrical or magnetic. So one may ask, which are the characteristics of a non-commutative space which rely on the spectral multiplicity of the Dirac operator? And this will allow to construct certain weights, which in some cases are called densities, when they are measurable, essentially, and to discuss for them the residues of the corresponding zeta functions and the hypertrace property they will carry. So there is, I think, no need to recall the notion of the spectral triple, in which we assume that the Dirac operator, the operator D, has a discrete spectrum in ways away from zero. In what follows, the zero eigenvalue are not is not so important, you will see. So of course there are many summability properties of one can which has been studied in connection with the Dirac operator, especially the infinity summability connected to the Dixmier ideal of a compact operator and to the Dixmier trace. In connection to the Dirac operator, in the case of a compact manifold, there is the famous trace theorems by which any pseudo-differential operator of order minus n, the dimension of the manifold, can be traced by the Dixmier trace, and the result can be expressed in terms of an ordinary integral of the symbol, essentially the trace of the symbol, principal symbol of the operator D. In particular, one can recover the volume, the integral with respect to the volume measure of the Riemannian manifold. And these are elaborated modern version of a formula that Weyl proved in a two-dimensional case more than one century ago concerning the eigenvalues, the asymptotic behavior of the eigenvalues of the Laplace operator of a bounded Euclidean plane set. Kohn proved by using the Dirac, the notion of spectral triples, several formulas in cyclic cohomology in which the operator, the result of the trace, the Dismay trace of certain operators is independent upon the ultra filter. In this case, we call the situation measurable, a measurable operator. And so we can ask in general to what extent the volume forms depends on the summability of the spectral triple. And one of the results of our work is that to remain in a commutative situation of a compact Riemannian manifold, one can recover the volume distribution, not the volume measure, but the volume distribution, so a probability distribution, a probability measure of the Riemannian manifold only using the spectral multiplicity of the Laplace operator, for example, or the Dirac operator. So the philosophy is that to discover the information which are carried not by the whole spectrum, but by the multiplicity only of the Dirac operator. So as a preliminary observation, one can recall the situation in which if mu is a random measure on the positive half line, its distribution function, which is defined in this way, in case the measure mu is diffused, is a diffused probability, the image measure by the distribution function of the same measure mu gives back the Lebesgue measure on the interval 0, 1. Or if mu is a discrete measure concentrated on some discrete set or sequence of points going to infinity, then the image measure of mu by its distribution function n of mu is just the counting measure on the natural number. So in this situation, one observed that the image measure by of a measure, the image of a measure by the, its own distribution function does not depend on the original measure. Now we fix the general setting in which we work is that of an unbounded non-negative self-adjoint operator, which has a discrete spectrum away from zero. So one can think to the Laplace or the Dirac operator of a compact manifold, or even other situation. And what follows, we take the convention that any functional calculi f of L of the operator L is zero on the kernel of L. So in this way, as I already noticed, the kernel of the zero eigenvalue of L doesn't play any role. So we can consider the eigenvalue counting function of operator L, the multiplicity function, and we can enumerate the spectra, the spectrum of L in two ways, or by repeating eigenvalues according to their multiplicity, or considering the eigenvalue distinct eigenvalues. And capital M, K, will denote the cumulated multiplicity, the sum of all multiplicity of the first N, or K, eigenvalues. So an elementary observation by which counting function n on lambda k tilde is equal to mk when x is equal to mk and on any number, positive number x is equal to mk if x is in between these the interval of two consecutive eigenvalues. So if we consider nl minus, so the left limit of the counting function, then n is of course monotone, non-decreasing, and is continuous on the right and bounded on the left-hand side. The second point is just the observation above. And moreover, the limsup of the ratio between the counting function at x and the left limit of the counting function itself is equal to the limsup of the ratio between two consecutives cumulated multiplicities. This is just some elementary observation. And then we can define by a functional calculus between the reciprocal of the function n, the counting function of L, of the operator L, a compact operator, which we call the spectral weight of associated to the operator L. So the spectral weight by its very definition depends only on the filtration, the increasing of the filtration of the spectral subspaces of L, not on the precise value of the eigenvalues of the operator L. In particular, if we take an increasing function f of L, we get the same spectral weight we get from L. So the spectral weight depends only on the spectral only on the filtration of the spectral subspaces. And from the above observation, some property comes. For example, the spectral weight is belongs to the dual Matsaif ideal L1 infinity. Its Dix-Mate traces is not greater than one for all ultra filter. And the limsup of n of L over n of L minus, if is bounded, is the number C, implies that the Dix-Mate traces of the spectral weight is greater than the reciprocal of C. If moreover, not the limsup, but the limit between n of L and its left limit, or better, between the two consecutives multiplicity, cumulated multiplicity, mk over mk minus one, if its number greater exists and is greater than C, implies that the Dix-Mate trace of the spectral weight is given by this this formula. In particular, or moreover, if the limit, the above limit is one, then the Dix-Mate trace of rho of L is equal to one for all ultrafilter omega. And in this case, we call rho L, so rho L is a measurable operator, compact operator, and in this case is called the spectral density. We call it the spectral density of L, of the initial operator. All these, apart from the third point, but all the other comes from the following, the observation, the elementary observation. According to the eigenvalues of the spectral weight rho of L. And so the following are equivalent. the limit between two consecutive cumulative multiplicity is equal to one, or the limit of the infinitesimal relative multiplicity, the relative multiplicity are infinitesimal, so the limit is zero, if and only if the counting function n of l is asymptotically continuous, so is asymptotic with a continuous function phi on the positive alpha line. In all these cases, rho of l, so is a spectral density, is a measurable weight, and the Gibbs matrix is unital, is equal to one. How to check that the counting function n of l is asymptotically continuous? For example, if the operator l has a sub-exponential spectral growth, that means that its partition function is defined on the wall for any positive, strictly positive inverse temperature, beta, and this is a regularly varying function in a certain sense, Karamata sense, then n of l is asymptotically continuous because is asymptotic to a multiple of z of l composed with 1 over x. The growth hypothesis, the sub-exponential spectral growth rate on l is equivalent to say that the average energy is finite at any inverse temperature in the Gibbs state. And if the first derivative of z is also regularly varying, this implies a certain behavior of the average energies at different temperature, a certain particularly regular behavior. The above criteria applied also to theta summable spectral triples, provided that the corresponding zeta function is regularly varying. Then we consider the zeta function of the spectral wave, which is defined for any complex number on the right hand side of the vertical line of real values equal to one. And in case if all eigenvalues would be equal to one, so all multiplicity would be unitary, this would coincide with the Riemann zeta function. In general, we have a residue property. If NL is asymptotically continuous, then the residue in this weak sense is equal to one. More regular situation, if a certain condition is satisfied, a condition which you see still involve only the multiplicity of the operator L, then the zeta function extends to a meromorphic function to a certain plane which include the value s, the number s equal to one, where the pole is simple, where the zeta function has a pole which is simple and a unital residue. Other condition which ensure the same conclusion can be derived assuming that the counting function n of l is asymptotically continuous with respect to a certain function phi with a certain remainder term. If the remainder term is of this type, power of a root of alpha root of phi, then still the zeta function can be extended on the same plane half plane with a unital residue in S equal 1. These properties are derived by comparison of our zeta function of the spectral weight or and the spectral density and the Riemann zeta function using multiplicities to compare them. One can recall various situations in which a commutative situation, in the sense that they deal with a compact Riemannian manifold and operators, elliptic operators on them, where the remainder of terms is known, certainly Normander asymptotic estimates for elliptic positive smooth pseudo-differential operators, in which the remainder terms provide that implies that the half plane can be bounded in this way. But Taylor proved that on the product of two spheres, one can have a better remainder term, and then the half plane of where is the meromorphic behavior is wider, and also a situation in which for a sub-elliptic operator, sum of square of two vector particular vector fields, the behavior is no more a power of x, so the behavior is not more a Laval, but even in this case one can deduce that at least that the spectral weight is a density. We still are in a measurable situation. Here is an example on free groups in which one can have measurability even if the trace, the Dixmier trace is different, is not one, is not unital. For example, if on a free group one consider the length function and the multiplication operator by the length function, then one can use the explicit knowledge of the multiplicity in this case and compute that the Dixmier trace in this case is given by this formula, and the zeta function can be extended to the right positive half plane with this residue. In case one consider the rho of L, the Dixmier, the weight, the spectral weight, one can consider on the corresponding positive functional, or we call them volume form. In case rho L is a density, so in case of measurability, these volume forms are states. To compute these volume forms, one can also use instead of rho L itself, one can use any function phi, which is asymptotic to the counting function, and also one can use is very useful this formula by Kari, Phillips, and Sukochev. Representing these the volume forms in terms of using an ultra filter on the positive real line, an ultra filter on the algebra L infinity over plus, instead than the usual ultra filter, Dixmier ultra filter on L infinity of n. If we compute the volume forms in a commutative situation, that means on a manifold, but manifold, what we get is this formula. in which you can see that we recover from the spectral subspaces, from the filtration of spectral subspaces, not exactly the measure M or the Riemannian measure M of the manifold, but the distribution, the probability distribution of the volume, means the measure M divided by the volume of the manifold. So this means that if we consider only the filtration of the spectral subspaces, we lose information about the global volume of the space, but we still have precise information concerning the distribution of the volume in the space. Similar result can be also obtained in the case of discrete groups, in which one can compute explicit these volume forms for any proper function, and for any, and so the associated operator L. There are also situations in which Euclidean situation in which a domain which has infinite volume, so a domain for which the value asymptotic formula cannot hold true, at least in the, as we know them, but in which the Laplace operator with Dirichlet condition, with vanishing condition on the boundary of the domain, has a discrete spectrum. For example, Barry Simon proved that in the case of the region enclosed between an hyperbola, the behavior of the counting functions is the following one. So it's not a behavior a la Weyl. But in this case, the formula we get above provide a probability density, provide a probability measure on this unbounded region, which should be interpreted as the geometric distribution of the space for a certain geometry of the space itself. A geometry which comes from a spectral geometry which is encoded in the Dirichlet Laplace operator of the region. And then we come to the third, in some sense, application of these ideas to trace theorems. Again, there is no need to recall the story in front of this audience. Trace theorems which deal with the existence of an hypertrace under certain conditions associated to the operator L with discrete spectrum. So we call the Lipschitz algebra, this the algebra of all operator, bounded operator, which have a bounded commutator with L, and we consider its non-closure. And the first, the result is the following. If the counting function is asymptotically continuous with an absolutely continuous function, so in particular a continuous function, so we still are in a situation of measurability of spectral density, existence of spectral density, but if the function is absolutely continuous and the ratio between its derivative and itself, so the logarithmic derivative of the function phi goes to zero, or in an alternative for an alternative assumptions, NL, the counting function is asymptotically continuous. That is equivalent to this hypothesis I. That means that the relative multiplicity are vanishing when k goes to infinity, and if this relative multiplicity are little of the spectral gaps sequence, then in this case the volume forms reconstructed by the spectral density rho of L are in fact hypertraces on A. That means that this identity. The second hypothesis in particular is verified if the spectral gaps of consecutive eigenvalues are uniformly bounded away from zero, a situation which has a certain is general, you know, in certain, at least in certain settings. Mm. For example, one can consider on the prime numbers the multiplication operator by the number, the prime number p. In this case, the prime number theorem tells us that the spectral density, the counting function, has exactly this behavior. So n of L is asymptotically continuous, and also the second set of assumptions, of hypotheses, of the above criteria are satisfied, then the volume forms define a hypertrace on the topless sister algebra, which is a sister algebra generated by the shift operator defined in this way, using the greatest prime p prime greater than a certain prime number p. In another situation, one can recall, one can use the construction of Voiculescu of a certain spectral triple in which the operator D, but in this case is a positive operator, which is start from a certain neighbor space H, from a certain filtration of subspaces. Then one consider this filtration of an algebra A, which is defined as a union of all of them, PK. Assume that this calligraphic A is dense in a sister algebra A. And then one can define this operator D, which has by construction a discrete spectrum coinciding with N. The multiplicity are given by the dimension of the subspaces of the filtration. And in this case, one compute that the spectral density, the spectral weight is given by this formula. In this case, all gaps are equal to one. So the condition, both the second set of condition of the criteria above concerning the existence of hypertrace is satisfied as soon as the ratio between the dimension of two consecutive subspaces of the filtration tends to one, has limit one. So in this case, we get an hypertrace on for any Dixmier ultra filter. This is an observation, but I want to conclude with some perspective. The idea to study the motivation to start to consider this kind of subjects comes from the idea to construct natural spectral triples associated to situation of non-commutative potential theory, especially Dirichlet forms, energy forms on non-commutative spaces. And to compute, or at least to evaluate, to establish conformal invariance in the sense of Alencon. And on the other side, to construct energy forms, Dirichlet forms, on algebras which are self-similar in a precise sense, especially the recently constructed the quantum gasket, a non-commutative generalization, quantization of the usual fractal set, the Sierpinski gasket, the usual, the classical Sierpinski gasket. And in another completely different direction, one could be interested in this paper by Adzamov, Eckelman, McDonald, Sukochev, and Zanin, which is a recent preprint of the last February, in which they use some idea we treated today to construct, to have a genuine construction of the density of states in solid state physics, in crystals or situated in discrete on discrete metric space, say. And so one could be interested in trying to establish the correspondence between the density of states, or to interpret the density of states as a spectral density in our sense we have seen today. And this concludes the exposition, for which I thank you.
Thank you, Fabio. So any question, remark?
Yeah, I might have one comment for the use of ultra filters in the Dixmier, yes, in the Dixmier trace. You know, I mean, I have always promoted the following fact, which I think can be used in many circumstances and which is much better than ultra filters. The point is that you never need the ultra filter property. You only need to have a functional which vanishes on the ideal of sequences going to zero. So, and in fact, what is quite remarkable is that, you know, there is this construction of Mokobosky, where what he constructs is a universally measurable such linear functional. And the advantage is that then you don't have to worry at all when you take the Dixmier trace of an integral of operators or anything like that, you know that the result will be the integral of the results. And I mean, this, I think, is often overlooked by people because, of course, I mean, it works with ultrafilters, and the advantage of ultrafilters is to know that, I mean, if you do the same result for all ultrafilters, you have convergence. On the other hand, okay, I always, you know, think that because this is essentially, I mean, I repeat, I claim to say that, you know, this way of integrating, which is the Dixmier trace, for me, it is the essence of integration, in the sense that you know, somehow I believe that any integral can be successfully put in these terms, and one understands much better what is going on. So in a way, then, you know, it would be surprising that one has to use ultrafilters and one doesn't have to use ultrafilters. I mean, there is this compatibility with measurability, which is quite important. But okay, this is just a side remark. I mean, you know, it doesn't touch what you were saying, which is quite interesting. Yeah.
Thank you.
Okay. Thank you. Any other question or remark?
Well, there is still one more comment.
Please, go ahead.
You know, in these old papers, I was making restrictions to have a finitely summable spectral triple and all that. Now, but in a way, I never obtained obstructions for finitely summable f. I mean, for the sign, if you want, for the f.
The sign of the Dirac.
Yeah, the sign. I mean, the conformal structure.
Yeah.
And there, for the conformal structure, I have no example where one would have an a priori obstruction to have a finite summability. You know, I mean. And there are many instances in which you cannot have the theta summable, the finally summable D, but you have the finally summable F in the conformal situation. So, I mean, this is something also rather mysterious, which I don't really understand.
Okay, Fabio?
No.
Okay, so any other question or remark from the audience? Maybe Richard? Sorry, Richard? No. Okay. So,
No, thank you. That was a nice talk.
Yes. Thank you. So let's then thank Fabio again for this very nice talk indeed. And you take care, all of you, and in 2 weeks again. And maybe before somewhere else. Okay.
Okay.
Oh, bye.
Good.
So how do I now switch it off the registration? Ciao Jean-Luc.
Ciao Gianni.
Come stai? Come va?
Benissimo, ti ringrazio. Non ti ho ancora risposto perché non conosco la risposta.
Va bene, d'accordo, non ti preoccupare. È comunque un piacere vederti. Facciamo, possiamo girare. Poiché non so come spegnere, possiamo stare qui a fare conversazione. No, non so come in realtà chiudere la registrazione, ma immagino che se chiudo la riunione, chiudo anche la registrazione. Va bene, Jean-Luc, sarai a Roma anche tu?
Non ci sarò.
Ah, oh, che peccato, Jean-Luc. Ah, sì. Oh, che peccato. Come faremo?
Ah.
Cioè, saremo tristi. Va bene. A presto, un abbraccio a tutti.
Ciao Gianni.
Ciao Daniele, ciao Gianni.
Ciao Daniele,
ciao Laszlo. Ciao Daniele, ciao Laszlo. Ciao ciao.
Ci sopravviveremo.
Ciao. No, this Italian's the best. Ok. I'll close now in 3, 1, 2, 3. Ciao.
Ciao.